Hello everyone, and welcome once again to Headquarters Ship Wellington, the home of the Honourable Company of Master Mariners, for this year's celebration of the Maritime Foundation's 26th Maritime Media Awards. With the country emerging from the effects of COVID, 2021 has seen a remarkable expansion of Britain's maritime profile and aspirations, exemplified by the government's predominantly maritime-based integrated review of security, defence and development, its championing of global Britain and its commitment to clean, safe, healthy and sustainably productive seas. British ports are transforming themselves in the wake of Brexit into multimodal transport and supply chain hubs and green energy pioneers. As we speak, the Royal Navy's carrier strike group led by HMS Queen Elizabeth is in the fifth month of her seven-month global deployment, operating with allies, promoting and protecting British interests, and reinforcing the democratic response to authoritarian regimes. In addition, this coming decade will see eight classes of warship or submarine under construction, with British companies leading several other major overseas programmes. Meanwhile, our fishing communities, merchant and diverse marine sectors will continue their vital contributions to our prosperity and international footprint. The old hands among you will recall that these awards were established to honour and remember the career and life of Desmond Whetton, whose distinctively direct and well-informed naval journalism was a popular, influential and widely read feature of the Daily Telegraph over two decades. It seems highly appropriate then to get underway with the Desmond Whetton Fleet Award for the Royal Navy team with 2021's Best Media Profile.
We are delighted to have won the Desmond Whetton Fleet Award for the Media Award 2021. It recognises a huge amount of effort by a very talented team here at 4-5 Commando and with support from the wider Navy media team. We are judged to have had projected the most positive image of the Naval Service over the preceding year and been the most proactive unit in the Corps with our media outreach, particularly our two videos, the Arctic Commando video for the winter deployment last year and the more recent Littoral Response Group North video talking about the future commando force. I should thank those who have been taken part in the video, Colour Sergeant Taylor, Sergeant Keenan, Lieutenant Millwall, and the background work behind the scenes of leading FOTS Clark. Once again, we are delighted and extremely proud to have won.
Now we would like to turn the spotlight onto another important feature of Global Britain's contribution to global harmony and stability. Starting in Glasgow in a few days' time, on the 31st of October, the UK will host COP26, the Conference of the Parties, those nations that signed up to the UN Framework on Climate Change 27 years ago in response to the challenge of climate change. Everyone will be aware that the United Kingdom is leading from the front in advocating and implementing a wide range of climate and environmental initiatives. Britain's maritime sector is also playing its part, and we want to take the opportunity in a series of quick burst happening now interludes to showcase some of the ways in which global Britain is contributing to this critical area of national and international development. The first interlude almost takes us back to the future.
My name's Gavin Allwright, and I'm the Secretary General of the International Windship Association, an organisation that's bringing wind propulsion back into commercial shipping. We have over 130 major shipping stakeholder members, and the association has been growing quite dramatically over the last couple of years. So what's actually happening in the sector? Well, there's a lot of exciting development. Currently, we have 15 large ships with wind propulsion installations on board, looking to have up to 20 by the end of the year, doubling for the next couple of years going forward. And I'd be remiss not to welcome you to the decade of wind propulsion, as we call it. And actually, the projections going forward are for, if the EU is to believe, up to 10,000 installations by the year 2030, pushing out to 2050. The UK Clean Maritime Plan has estimated between 40 to 45% of the world fleet would have wind propulsion installations on board, something in the region of 40,000 ships. So it's exciting times. And if you want to follow the wind, we're more than happy to take you with us. Thank you.
The first of the Maritime Foundation's own awards is the Babcock International First Sea Lords Award for the best use of digital media. The shortlist came down to three very strong candidates. Firstly, Illuminated River, a beautifully designed site with stunning photography and a fresh insight into the character and architecture of London's bridges. One Ocean Hub, a comprehensive, intelligible site that is packed with the latest ocean research and supports the UN's Sustainable Development Goals. And finally, the Thames Festival Trust, which pulls together in one place all the artistic, educational and heritage events that happen on and along London's river. And the winner, with its clever and impactful theme, as the judges put it, is One Ocean Hub.
My name is Elisa Morgera. I'm the director of the One Ocean Hub. I'm professor of global environmental law at the Strathclyde University Law School in Glasgow, UK. I am delighted and honored to receive the first Sea Lords Digital Media Award of the Maritime Foundation. At the One Ocean Hub, this award has really been seen as particularly important because it recognizes our effort in presenting research on the ocean in an inclusive manner in a challenging digital environment. We endeavor to communicate ocean issues in a clear and engaging way so that a broad and diverse audience can use our research to ask for change. We're trying to make this impact also at the upcoming UN Conference on Climate Change in Glasgow in the next few weeks. I would like to thank in particular the talented people that created our digital presence, our communication officer, Laura Merilainen at the University of Strathclyde, the digital agency Holgrain Digital, who designed the Hub website, and also my colleague and Hub co-director, Dr. Dylan Megari at Rhodes University in South Africa, because he created the creative visuals that form the backbone of our unique look of the website. Thank you so much also to all the researchers across the Hub, including early career researchers that continue to provide engaging content for the website.
Hello, I'm Tony Long, CEO at Global Fishing Watch. Happening now, around the world, human activities are putting enormous pressure on marine ecosystems. For example, one in five fish are thought to be caught illegally, and that means $23 billion worth of revenue is lost to illegal activity each year. Global Fishing Watch is advancing ocean governments by providing technologies to track more than 65,000 fishing vessels at a global scale and for free. Since 2016, we have established relationships with eight key fishing nations, and we hope to be working with 20 fishing nations by the end of 2023. By doing this, we can drive a transformational change in how we manage our oceans.
At the constant risk of my domestic harmony, I always firmly assert with the poet Petrarch that there's no such thing as too many books. That philosophy has been strongly reinforced in the large number of very worthy and compelling candidates for the Mountbatten Literary Award for Best Book. In this category, certificates of merit go to Madhouse at the End of the Earth by Julian Sancton, an account of the severe privation suffered and, spoiler alert, just about overcome by the Belgian Antarctic research ship Belgica at the end of the 19th century. Mutiny on the Spanish Main, describing the events associated with and following a particularly vicious mutiny aboard HMS Hermione in 1797. And The Brilliant Abyss, which adds another eloquent, urgent warning about the deteriorating state of our oceans, both now and into the future. However, the standout winner of the Mountbatten Award this year is Dr. Andrew Boyd's definitive, authoritative analysis and sparkling account of British naval intelligence through the 20th century, which was described as comprehensive and scholarly by the judges.
I'm absolutely delighted to have won the Maritime Foundation Mountbatten Literary Award for 2021. and feel greatly privileged to join such a distinguished group of previous recipients. It's wonderful that British naval intelligence through the 20th century should receive this recognition from the maritime community. In writing the book, I wanted to emphasize the central role of intelligence in Britain's recent naval heritage, and the award will help bring that important story to a wider audience. I would like to think it will also honor all those who contributed to the success of British naval intelligence in this period.
I'm Paul Turner. I'm the Managing Director of CMB.Tech. We're part of a large shipping organisation, CMB. And what are we doing now? We've decided hydrogen is the way forward. So we are looking at how we can decarbonise our fleet using hydrogen as the means to reduce our CO2. And we have launched our first vessel in 2017, the Hydroville. And the second vessel was launched earlier this year, the Hydro Bingo in Japan. And as we speak today, we are launching our third vessel, a crew transfer vessel on hydrogen. We believe hydrogen is the answer. We also understand that it's difficult to carry enough hydrogen on board. So for our larger vessels, we're looking at how we can carry that hydrogen on the ships, and we're looking at ammonia or methanol or other hydrogen carriers such as LOHCs. We are very convinced that we mustn't let best become the enemy of better.
Despite the COVID-19 restrictions, the maritime sector has held up well in TV and film this year, with crews and producers proving creative and resourceful in equal measure. The result is a crop of high quality, well-researched and original entries. Three productions competed to make it to the shortlist of the Donald Gosling Award for the best TV or film production. In order of release, these were Estonia, The Find That Changes Everything, a penetratingly executed series on one of Europe's worst ever peacetime shipping disasters, made in Norway for the Discovery Channel, with a startling new revelation. On board Britain's nuclear submarine Trident, the accomplished presenter Rob Bell served his time at sea in the Trident submarine HMS Vengeance to provide key insights into the little-known world of our nuclear deterrent, delivering a useful antidote to the fantasy submarine world inaccurately and disingenuously portrayed in the BBC crime drama Vigil. Finally, the latest series of BBC Two's Cornwall, This Fishing Life, demonstrated authenticity, a close eye for detail, and human sympathy in representing and interpreting the distinctive lives and culture of Cornish fishermen and their families. The winner of the Gosling Award is Estonia, The Find That Changes Everything. The series was particularly distinguished by the detailed determination with which the producers from Monster TV revisited and investigated the circumstances of this tragedy, the sensitivity with which they spoke with survivors, and the accuracy with which they recreated the sinking. They also discovered critical new evidence that was entirely missed by the official investigators. Let's have a look at a short extract.
Jag hade ju precis blivit pappa. Det var inte många månader som min dotter Vilma var då. Och det här var faktiskt första gången som jag var någon längre tid hemifrån. Jag var på Estonia på grund av att jag skulle på en konferensresa. Och jag var väldigt mycket på båten under tiden så båten låg i hamn.
I remember arriving at the port. I was just amazed at the sheer size of the ship.
Den är stor, ganska stor, den är 150 meter lång drygt. För estländarna så är det ju något stort och nytt som kommer.
Alla vi gäster var ju naturligtvis väldigt stolta över det att vi hade en så modern och vacker färja och så vidare. Det kanske också var en symbol för hur vi hade kommit redan på några år framåt i tiden och kunde visa upp en sådan färja där de som åkte till Estland för första gången kanske i sitt liv.
Hello everybody. On behalf of the whole production team, Discovery Networks, and our production company Monster, I would like to thank you for this great honor. Thank you to the Maritime Foundation and the jury for the interest they've shown for this series and about the sinking of the MS Estonia. Our aim with this series was from the very start to get new facts on the table and in doing that, contribute to improving safety at sea. None of this would have been possible without the stories and contribution of those who survived the sinking and those who lost someone they loved. So our greatest thanks goes to them, and we share this incredible honor with all affected by this terrible tragedy. Thank you very much.
My name is Rob Stevens, and I'm the chairman of the tidal energy company, Perpetua's Tidal Energy Centre. And what's happening now in our company is that we are a pioneering 30 megawatt tidal energy site to the south of the Isle of Wight in the final stages of reconsent for onshore planning with the aim of delivering electricity to the grid by 2025. We're capitalising on the progress of the tenacious British turbine manufacturers, Simic Atlantis, Orbital, Nova, Sustainable Marine, have all built or in the process of building production level turbines with the capacity to harness the enormous potential and predictability of nature's power, the tides. They've already generated over 30 gigawatts of electricity into the UK grid and exporting to Japan and Canada. Their vision, now reinforced by an emerging UCL study, is that there's a potential to generate 11 to 17 gigawatts of power from the tidal sites around our coast for the UK grid by 2050. Now that's 20% of our current demand. Our partner in this venture is the European Marine Energy Centre, EMEC. They're the global leader in marine energy expertise and have tested 30 wave and tidal projects and shown that tidal energy is commercially viable. Their initial investment of 36 million in 2003 now delivers 306.3 million GVA, that's additional value, to Orkney. In fact, they're generating so much clean energy that the local grid can't absorb it. And they're now making hydrogen to power the ferries and the local tidal, and the local transport. Now, all of this to me proves that tidal is way beyond the perceived barrier of short-term cost of tidal energy. This is a clean, predictable, unlimited natural source of power, which is in complete harmony with the underwater environment and could become cost-effective by 2030. It's a really huge opportunity for Britain to strengthen our grid, reduce energy imports with clean energy, and of course, to capture a huge share of the global market of £76 billion. Provided, of course, we've got the courage to take it, and preferably before COP26.
Finally, the award that started this event a quarter of a century ago, the Desmond Wetton Award for Best Journalism, which is given to the journalist who has done the most to promote the importance of the sea and seafaring to our island nation over the last year. This year, for the first time and with genuine sadness, we must say has done the most. David Linkey, the late editor of Fishing News, had a passionate vocational commitment to the fishing industry. After a career in teaching, he became a highly regarded and active freelance reporter and correspondent with Fishing News. He was appointed editor in 2016 and continued to travel the length and breadth of Britain, chasing news and stories for his journal and enthusiastically promoting the interests, image and work of the sector. It has been rightly said that the detailed information he captured and conveyed was fascinating, especially to those who needed the technical information to help make their own decisions. It is doubtful whether any other person was so well connected and so well respected across the whole UK fishing industry. I recall that he was as enthusiastic about a small Northumbrian cobble as he was about the latest pelagic trawler. He scarcely let up until a few days before his untimely death from cancer in June this year. David leaves his wife Liz, daughter Catherine, and son Andrew, and his many friends and contacts across the fishing industry. David Linke is the 2021 Desmond Whetton Award winner for Best Journalism.
I'm Tim Oliver. I used to be the editor of Fishing News before Dave Linke, who I'm really pleased to hear has won the Desmond Whetton Award. David started working for Fishing, well, he began his career with Fishing News as a freelance when he was a school teacher. And his hobby was to go around the ports in his school holidays with his camera, photographing fishing vessels, talking to fishermen. And he just generally loved the fishing industry. And he used to send me freelance articles, which were very good. And he always wanted to work for Fishing News. And eventually a vacancy came up and we appointed Dave as the Fishing News correspondent for Scotland and the north of England. He also was the editor of a fishing vessel directory, which we produced at that time. And David was the most committed and passionate and enthusiastic reporter that you could possibly have on the fishing industry. He loved the industry and the fishermen. He knew every fisherman almost from throughout Britain and Ireland. He travelled incessantly from Newlyn up to Shetland. To report on new boats and do port features, etc., etc. He was fortunate in that he was a man, I suppose, who turned his hobby into his profession, and hence he just loved what he did. He was greatly respected by the fishing industry and the fishermen for his commitment to them, for his knowledge. He had an encyclopedic knowledge of fishing vessels. He knew just about the history of every fishing vessel in the country. He knew everyone that was being built, where it was being built, when it was going to be launched, etc. He was invariably invited to launches of new boats in Scotland and elsewhere. And he very often went on trials of new boats when they were testing them out to make sure everything was working okay. And in that way, he just became a legend, really, in the fishing industry, just known everywhere and by everybody. I think he spent more time in Peterhead than most of the Peterhead fishermen. He was up there all the time and elsewhere, of course. It's very hard, actually, to overstate the commitment that Dave had for the fishing industry. He just lived and breathed it. He worked 24/7, 365 days a year. He worked weekends. He was... He just was a Trojan, a workhorse who loved the job he did and loved the industry he worked for. I don't think anybody is more deserving of the Desmond Whetton Award than Dave Linke. It's just a pity that he isn't still with us to receive the award.
The Maritime Foundation's media awards are unique. They celebrate dedication and commitment to the maritime sector, and they do that while balancing an understanding of the past, an encouragement of the present, and offering a vision of a cleaner and greener and more sustainable future. The media landscape has changed significantly since the Maritime Foundation was set up, and no doubt it will continue to evolve. But whatever medium we use, we will continue to praise excellence, accuracy, and ambition.
And with that word from our awards chairman, our revels now are ended. Our website contains all the awards and candidates in detail, and our annual magazine, Maritime 2021, covering all aspects of global Britain, free online and available in print for the cost of the postage. Finally, and most sincerely, we remain grateful to our generous and closely engaged sponsors, notably the Gosling Foundation, without whom these awards could not take place. We also appreciate the support of all those who have an interest in the use and future of the sea, and Britain's revived role as Global Britain as a major presence on the primary medium of access and exchange that is the sea. As Jacques-Yves Cousteau said, for nations and individuals, the sea, once it casts its spell, holds one in its net of wonder forever. Let me wish you all the best in your endeavours and aspirations, and encourage you to join us again next year for the 2022 Maritime Foundation Maritime Media Awards.
For more updates about the Maritime Media Awards, follow us on Twitter.